All right, let's talk about energy associated with changes in state. We're going to pull back in a conversation that you've already had, a topic that you've already studied. Recall from your first semester of chemistry that when a substance heats up or cools down, the amount of energy required for that substance to heat up or cool down, as long as you're at constant pressure, is the heat, which is symbolized with a lowercase q. That's the amount of heat that it takes in order to heat up or cool something down. And this is calculated using something called the specific heat capacity. The specific heat capacity of a substance is usually a tabulated value you're going to look up, times the amount of substance, times the change in temperature. The change in temperature is usually in degrees Celsius, or it can be in Kelvin, since it is a change in temperature. The amount of change for degrees Celsius is exactly the same as the amount of change for degrees Kelvin. The amount of the substance is usually in grams, although the unit that you choose for the amounts depends on your specific heat capacity. And again, this is usually a table value, a value that you look up out of a table, and it is in the units of energy, which is, again, there's a variety of units for energy, but most commonly we see it in joules or kilojoules, per or divided by the amount of substance, such as the grams or moles, depending on what table you look at, divided by the change in temperature units or the degrees Celsius, again, or degrees Kelvin. So a specific heat capacity would have a unit of energy per amount per degrees per change in temperature. For example, the specific heat capacity of water, liquid water, is 4.184 joules per gram degrees Celsius. And so it takes 4.184 joules of energy to heat 1 gram of water up by 1 degree Celsius. Likewise, 1 gram of water will cool down 1 degree Celsius by giving off 4.184 joules of energy. If you Google tables of specific heat capacities, sometimes you'll find units other than joules for energy. Sometimes you'll find, instead of grams, you'll find moles of the substance, in which case you're going to have to adjust your formula. And sometimes you'll find them per degree Kelvin instead of degree Celsius, but numerically that's exactly the same thing. Now, in this chapter, in this material, we're not only looking at substances heating up and cooling down, more specifically, we're looking at phase transitions or changes of state. Phase transitions include substances going between solids, liquids, and gases. The phase transition between solid and liquid, if you're going from solid to liquid, we call that melting, but we also refer to that as fusion. The process of fusion is essentially melting. The process of going from liquid to solid, we call that freezing, or we call that crystallization. The phase transition going between liquid and gas, from liquid to the gas phase, we call that boiling or vaporization. We also can refer to that as evaporation. Going from gas to liquid, we call that condensation. Each of these phase transitions requires energy. In order to go from solid to liquid, you have to give energy to the particles, which still keeps them close together but allows them to flow. To go from liquid to gas, you have to give energy to the particles that allows them to overcome the intermolecular forces associated with them to allow them to get far apart, which is what the particles look like in the gas phase. The amount of energy for each of these phase transition is an enthalpy change as long as you're at constant pressure, so it's a delta H, an enthalpy change. So each of these phase transitions for a particular substance, there is a certain amount of energy that's required to cause that substance to undergo one of these phase transitions per amount of substance. So we often can look up values for enthalpies of phase transitions. So those are delta H's with some sort of subscript to indicate the phase transition. And those values are usually in an energy unit. Again, we can talk about joules. Usually they're pretty large, so often we'll see them in kilojoules per amount. So an enthalpy of a phase transition would be an amount of a value for energy per amount of substance. The amount of substance might be in grams, but it is commonly in moles. So we have an amount of energy per mole, a molar phase transition. Again, the unit for energy, we commonly see this in kilojoules, but be aware you might see other units besides kilojoules for energy. And so the amount of energy, again, for a particular phase transition, the amount of energy or the enthalpy change, which is the heat change in order to melt something or boil something, you're looking at that delta H for the phase transition times the amount. All right, so let's talk about how we would put this together to work on a problem. If you are heating up a substance, let's talk about a heating curve. We can graph this, we can represent it graphically. All right, what we see here is we see a representation of a temperature on this axis versus time, or which would also represent the energy added on this axis. And so over time, if I take a substance and I heat it up, all right, I start adding energy over time, what I will observe is that the temperature will rise until it reaches a point that the temperature levels off, even though I'm continuing to add energy to the substance. At this point, this flat region, the substance is melting, or that's the fusion process, if you will. So we have a solid to liquid phase transition where it requires more energy input, but the temperature stays constant. Once the entire substance is melted, a further input of energy, and we're talking about this region of the graph, is going to cause the temperature to go up. Again, until it reaches a point that you're at the boiling point. And at the boiling point, a further input of energy will cause the substance to boil or vaporize. And so once everybody is a gas, once all the particles are in the gas phase, then a further input of energy will cause the temperature rise again. And so we see transitions, and my graph is obviously written without any imperfections, and as we know, experimental data sometimes doesn't look so perfect, but essentially this is the shape of the graph that we'd get if you were to plot temperature versus energy input over time. You would see very close to these straight lines that are represented here. But again, this is a little bit of an idealized sort of shape. On the positions of the graph where the temperature is rising, and that would be this position, and this position, we can calculate how much energy is put into the system from what we learned in Chem 1, the amount of energy, which is the amount of heat, which is the enthalpy change, which is heat at constant pressure, is equal to the specific heat capacity times the amount times the change in temperature. I am using the symbol C for specific heat capacity, but please be aware some textbooks list it as an S instead of a C. M stands for the mass of the substance, because by and large the specific heat capacities are going to be per gram. And delta T is the temperature change of the substance. We just talked about this earlier. This calculates the amount of energy required to go from T1 to T2. I would look at my temperature change on the axis, and I would use the specific heat capacity for the gas during this transition, for the liquid during this transition, and it's going to be a different numerical value, and for the solid here at the temperature change here at the bottom of my graph. So I'll have three separate values for delta H for these three positions on the graph. I would simply calculate them, don't round in the middle, keep all your sig figs, and then I could add these three values together to get the amount of energy, the enthalpy change, for raising the temperature from some bottom point to some top point. But that's not the entire answer, that's not the entire amount of energy it takes, because it also takes energy at these phase transitions. So for each of these phase transitions, I would calculate an enthalpy change for that phase transition. It has nothing to do with a temperature change, because the temperature isn't changing. It will be the enthalpy of the phase transition times the amount. Most commonly, we're going to see these enthalpies of phase transitions per mole. So I would need the amount in moles in that case. If I find the enthalpy of the phase transition in grams, then I would need the amount in grams. So you do have to watch your units very, very carefully. So I would calculate a delta H for this position, and then I would simply add all of my delta H's together, all of the delta H's from the temperature changes, all of the delta H's from the phase transitions, to get some overall energy change to take my substance from this temperature to this temperature. Now, this graph represents every single phase transition and temperature change for every single phase. You might come across a problem that starts in the solid region, but the final temperature is in the liquid region, so you wouldn't need to take into account the phase transition of boiling, vaporization. And so this is how you would calculate an energy associated with taking a substance and changing its temperature from some starting to some ending point. This type of heating curve, all of these enthalpy changes are positive because you're putting in this amount of energy. If I have a cooling curve, I'm just going to do this freehand, if I have a substance that is cooling down, then I would calculate the enthalpy changes of each of these positions in exactly the same fashion, whether it's a phase transition or a temperature change, and I would still add them all together, but in this case, that amount of energy is being released. This is an exothermic process. And so the final answer for the delta H would actually be negative in this case. The final answer for delta H on a heating process is positive. The final delta H for a cooling process is negative because it's exothermic and that amount of heat is being released.